In the past, I've talked about useful rescue boot drives you can make in case your operating system ever breaks and becomes unusable. But there is one super exclusive official Windows bootable recovery toolkit created by Microsoft called DART, or Diagnostic and Recovery Toolset. And this is actually included in something else called the Microsoft Desktop Optimization Pack, or MDOP. And it actually has some pretty cool tools that aren't available anywhere else. And I had actually known about this Microsoft DART toolkit for a while, but I could never get my hands on it because it's typically only available to certain enterprise customers who have volume licensing. Until now, that is. That's right, I was finally able to get my hands on it so I can check it out and, of course, show you all how it works and show you the tools within it. Now, how did I get it? Well, it turns out because I'm part of Microsoft's MVP program, if you don't know about that, I have access to it. You see, Microsoft MVPs are given a Visual Studio Enterprise subscription that apparently gives you access to almost literally every program Microsoft has ever made. Everything from the latest Office apps to this random little GIF animator program they released in 1996. But as I just recently found out, it also has that desktop optimization pack I mentioned before that includes DART. If you're curious, I'll put a link in the description where you can download a Excel list of all the software for different Visual Studio plans, and let me know if there's any other weird or cool programs you think I should talk about. The specific plan I have is Visual Studio Enterprise NFR, or not for resale. So anything that has a checkbox in that column, I'll be able to check out. Now, I already know many of you are gonna ask if I can upload this toolkit somewhere so everyone can download it, and the answer is definitely no, I cannot. It would break several piracy laws and several agreements I am beholden to. This is not free software. It's technically paid behind several licenses, so I can't just give it out, obviously. So the best I can do is just show you it, but all that being said, don't worry. Besides the cool factor, while some of the tools aren't available anywhere else, they don't really do anything unique, and you could easily find some free alternatives if you really wanted to. Anyway, enough chit-chat, let's get to the fun stuff. So like I said, the DART toolkit is a bootable recovery image. So what I'll do is show you the process of creating this bootable image and all the additional features and stuff you can choose to add to it. And then, of course, I'll show you the toolkit itself when you do boot it up, how it works. So to get this toolkit set up and create the bootable image, it requires a few things to get started. First, you need the MS DART installer, of course, and that's found within that Microsoft Desktop Optimization Pack ISO. It gets downloaded as an ISO file. And there's actually several versions. The latest is 10, and when you go into it, there's lots of languages. You can choose 32 or 64-bit, and it's just an MSI installer. It also requires you to have installed the Windows Assessment and Deployment Kit, or ADK, though this anyone can download, it's free, and specifically you need the Windows 10 ADK. You'll also need the Windows PE, or Pre-Installation Environment add-on for the Windows ADK, and you'll also need a copy of a Windows 10 Installation Media ISO. Oh, and for some reason it doesn't work on Windows 11, so I have to run it in a Windows 10 virtual machine. Then you can actually install DART, and it comes with a few things, but the one we care about is this DART Recovery Image Creator, and then once it's installed, we can just run that. And now we can get on to the process of actually creating the bootable image. First, it just asks you to select the mounted location for the installation media, and then it lets you choose which tools to actually include. Now, we can go over these later when I actually show you them working, but we obviously want them all, so I'm just gonna keep them all checked. Then there's an option to include a tool that lets you access the computer remotely, but as you'll see, it just shows up as another tool, so I can include that. Next are some advanced options. So here you can manually add drivers that you know you might need, but might not be pre-installed with Windows. There's also the WinPE tab for including additional components from the pre-installation environment. I'm not sure what most of these do, to be honest, but you can include things like PowerShell, this one for supporting encrypted drives, and this other one just as an example. You can also increase the scratch space size, like if there is somehow no room on the hard drive, although it only goes up to 512. Then the Crash Analyzer tab just lets you choose which debugging tools the Crash Analyzer tool will use. And I'm just gonna select use the ones on the computer, but you should probably download it yourself and include it because most computers probably won't actually have them. But the thing is, it does require you to install Visual Studio, which is a huge download, and I didn't feel like going through all that. Next, you can choose what formats to make the image. So here it will create as an ISO and a Windows imaging format, another type of disk image, and also create a PowerShell script that will let you automatically recreate the image using the settings you just picked. There's also this option to edit the image to add more stuff, and we'll see that in a second. Then you just hit prepare and off it goes, starting to create this image. But before it finishes, there is one last step if you selected that edit image option. And here you can open the temporary directory with what it will include in the final image. And you can add your own files or programs, whatever you want. You can see it looks like a regular Windows directory structure. And I assume any programs you include would have to be portable versions, though it even also has a users directory. Maybe if you wanted to be able to copy over certain regular files or documents, you can just include anything in there. And then finally, once you have it all set up, you can hit create and let it finish. Finally, it gives you an option to make a bootable USB or CD out of the ISO. Though I'm instead going to use a program called Ventoy, which is a program I made a video about a while ago. I'll have it pop out, and it just makes it really easy to put a bunch of bootable images on one USB drive. Anyway, you can see it put both the images and the PowerShell script in a folder, and I think this boot.wim file is actually also included in the ISO file anyway. At least I assume so. It's the exact same size. So after doing all that, we now have the bootable image file ready to go. So let's go over to the computer, boot this up, and check it out. All right, so when you first boot it up, it will ask you if you want to initialize network connectivity in the background. I'm just gonna hit yes, and then you give it a second to load. Here it's gonna ask you for the keyboard layout, and then this looks like the usual Windows recovery environment, but if you go to troubleshoot, now you'll see this new option for Microsoft Diagnostics and Recovery Toolkit. If you go to the advanced options, again, it's the same stuff you're usually used to, but obviously we want to go into this one. Then you can choose the operating system. I guess if you have multiple installed, you'll be able to select from it. And here we go. So these are all the tools we selected in the menu when we were creating the image. And why don't we just quickly go through all these? So we could start off with the registry editor. This is what you've seen before. It's the typical registry editor already built into Windows. Nothing really special here. Explorer, this actually looks different from the Windows Explorer. This has this, on the left, this tree view, and basically the C drive is the Windows installation that's on the actual computer that you're trying to recover and mess with. D drive, this is the USB drive, basically, that was booted from, and then boot X, this is like a temporary RAM disk that is like the virtual version of Windows you're running from. And you can see here, this is gonna have all the stuff. If we were to add some of those custom items, like I mentioned, if we wanted to add some documents or whatever to one of these folders, I'm betting it would show up here. You got the Windows System 32 with a lot of stuff you'd typically expect. But other than that, there's nothing really special. It just lets you browse the disks. Next, we have Locksmith. This lets you reset local account passwords. So if you have a Microsoft account, it's not gonna work with that, but if it's a local password, then you can reset any of them and you just type in a new one. This is not anything special. There's plenty of tools that will also do this that are freely available. So nothing special here. Solution Wizard. This basically just walks you through and will help you choose which tool you wanna use if you're not sure what's going on. So system will not start correctly. Let's see. Perform a repair, and it actually asks quite a few questions, didn't realize. So it'll kind of help you if you have no idea what to choose, but usually there's not that many tools. I think you could probably figure out what you wanted to do. Then we have this crash analyzer. This allows you to analyze crash dumps. I don't think there's any crashes on this computer anyway, but this will ask you for where to point to the debugging tools. And you have to have it either on the computer you're debugging or, like I showed you before, include it, which does require Visual Studio to be installed, which I didn't feel like doing. TCP IP config, this is just the usual properties menu basically for any network adapter you can bring up in Windows normally, so nothing new here at all. File restore, this one is kind of interesting and self-explanatory. Let's just try typing in a star so it'll find anything. I guess I didn't really delete that much on this virtual machine, but you can see some are coming up and you get the idea. And interestingly, it'll also show this folder structure, so you can actually look to see if there's any deleted files in a specific location, which is kind of cool. You can also specify when it was last modified if you're looking for a size, so you can narrow it down a bit. You'll also notice on the right, if you scroll over, it'll tell you the recoverability probability, I guess. So this one, it says unlikely. You can look at the file properties, that sort of thing. So pretty cool. Hotfix uninstall. So this allows you to uninstall any little updates or hotfixes that Windows Update may have installed and messed something up. So you can see if we hit next, it'll search for all of them. All right, so here you can see all the hotfixes that have been installed. I think most of these are probably installed along with Windows, I guess, because they're all around the same time. But if you wanted to, you could, let's uninstall the Windows Media Player package. You can see some details about it. Shows you all that. Next, and it'll just uninstall it. And then it says succeeded. Next, we have Disk Commander, and this lets you recover master boot record, GUI partition table, recover volumes that may have been deleted. So this one's actually a really cool tool. If the bootloader or whatever boot record is corrupted, you can just run it. Although you don't really have too many options. It literally just says it's going to overwrite it. So probably only use this if you're sure that it's messed up. I'm just going to hit no. If you accidentally deleted a partition, this will apparently let you recover that. That's kind of cool. And also, I guess you can save the current partition tables. So maybe if you want to back things up before doing anything, it lets you do that too. And it looks like if you go and recover volumes, it'll have you back up if you want the current partition table to a file. I'll just hit no and then see what happens. It looks like it didn't actually find any, which makes sense. I didn't actually delete any partitions. Then we have SFC scan. And this one's interesting because normally you run SFC scan now from the command line, but this basically seems to be a GUI version of it. So you can have it scan and repair automatically, which is the usual thing it does, or scan and prompt you. I'll just hit that and we can see what happens afterwards. All right, that took a lot longer than expected. And it says no corrupt system files were detected as expected. Next, we can take a look at disk wipe. This one is pretty self-explanatory. And you can choose the volume or an entire disk, which would include multiple volumes. And you can choose either a single pass and overwrite with pseudo random data, or four passes, which is standard by the Department of Defense, I guess. So yeah, if you wanted to completely wipe a drive and make sure it's not recoverable, you could do it like this. Now we can look at search, self-explanatory. It looks similar to the file recovery one. And this one again requires you to use wildcards if you don't want to search it directly. So I know there's some files named Dart. We can put that in. Again, you get some parameters if you want. Let's just hit search and a whole bunch come up. So you can see it's searching the whole drive. There's nothing really special here. I think you get the idea. It shows you a little bit of info about the file that it found. There's no other options besides these parameters here. So pretty straightforward. Now we can look at computer management, which is a cool one. And this is basically going to show you a lot of management consoles that are sort of available in regular Windows, but a couple of them are different. So the Event Viewer, you're probably familiar with that one. You can obviously look at that in regular Windows. So you have the Windows logs, pretty much what you'd expect. Same stuff as you'd see in the regular one. You can look at the system information, so it'll tell you all the names of all the stuff, the specs. Then there's auto runs. This one's cool. So this looks really similar to what you'd see in the sys internals auto runs, although it doesn't look like it's quite as robust as that, but it still shows you a whole bunch of stuff. So startup programs set by the system, the user. There's not much here, obviously, because I don't have anything installed on the virtual machine, really. The local service, network service. So you can see just things that are starting up, where the registry keys are that are causing it to be started up. And you can even see stuff that's from the shell. So not just necessarily programs, but also shell extensions, stuff like that. So pretty cool. And then services and drivers. So services, this is, I think, the same as the services.msc menu you can bring up in Windows. So nothing new here. Although this one, drivers, I don't remember seeing this anywhere. You can tell me if I'm wrong, but this seems to be kind of a hybrid between running the sc.exe and querying the drivers, and also like the device manager and sorting by drivers. Seems like you get a lot of that information, except in a GUI. I haven't seen this particular management console anywhere, but again, you can let me know. So it'll tell you all the possible drivers, I guess, that are installed currently in Windows, and you can see some properties about them. And also startup type. This is another thing I've not seen in the context of drivers. You know, usually you see the startup for services type, you can do it automatic, but I've never seen it for drivers before. So that's definitely interesting. You have some different types. So that's kind of cool. And then finally, we have disk management. This is the same as the disk partition manager that is also in Windows. In the settings up here, there's nothing special. So that's about it. Then finally, we have remote connection. Remember, this was the optional checkbox we had, and it will basically allow you to have the help desk, they say, I guess if you're at a company, access the computer. So it'll show you the ticket number, the local IP address, the port to connect to, and then it just says waiting for connection. I tried to connect to it with the remote desktop program from my current computer, but it wasn't working, so I don't know what the deal is. But yeah, it's there if you need it. And then finally, there's help, which just shows you a page of some instructions and stuff. So you can see to start the tools, although I think if you've already gotten to this point, you're pretty good on that. One thing that's interesting, though, it says open a command prompt, the command prompt tool. I do not actually see that here. I know you can open up the Explorer and you can search through System32, I looked and it is in here, but I'm kind of surprised that really there's no tool showing the command prompt. I know usually you can also hit Shift F10. That doesn't also bring it up. So yeah, that's basically it. There's nothing else really to look at. If you hit close, it just brings you back to this. And I guess you would use this to get to the command prompt is what you would do. So actually that kind of makes sense. So yeah, the usual stuff is in here. And then if you need to access whatever tool, you just launch it through that. All right, so hopefully you guys found this video pretty cool. Let me know what you think down in the comments. Maybe there are some free alternative bootable tools that you could recommend that are alternatives to this. If you did enjoy it, of course, give it a big thumbs up for the YouTube algorithm. It really helps out. And also maybe considering checking out some other videos I've made. And if you like what you see, be sure to subscribe. I make videos usually Wednesday and Saturday. If you want to keep watching, I'll put two videos here I recommend. One is talking about that Ventoy program I mentioned before. And another one is also about some bootable rescue USB drives that you can make. So I'll put both those links right there. Probably the Ventoy one is worth watching first. So be sure to check those out. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.